So the other another method that is used is called as chemical oxygen demand. So here I think we do not rely on biodegradation. There is a direct oxidizing agent that is used. So under acidic conditions, so you have the equation. Let me not write this equation. So we have organic compounds, or we call it as organic load, in the presence of acidic and oxidizing conditions gives you CO2 plus H2O plus the organic compounds contains a CH, O and N generally in some ratio, okay. So you can either get NH3 or if you have other compounds like S and X and all that, you get HX, you can get H2S or you can get SO2 depending on what is forming. Typically you may get SO2 and or something else, but this is the main reaction. So strong acid is used. One method, standard method, calls for the use of Cr2O3 plus H2SO4. It's called chromic acid. It's chromium trioxide with concentrated sulfuric acid. And usually, what is used is it's a back titration. It's called an excess method. So you add a large amount of acid. You don't know how much acid to add for it to react. So you add an excess of acid, and you also add another reagent. Okay. So it's called as a what we add is ferrous ammonium sulfate. As FAS. So this titrates the excess H2SO4 plus Cr2O3. So what we do is we take some amount of sulfuric acid, this chromium trioxide, some say we have some volume of what we add into our. So the method for this is you take again a certain volume of water, you add the oxidizing agent and the and then let it digest for a long time. So long time is again relative. I think now the standard method is about half an hour or 45 minutes, 2 hours. There is an accelerated method also, no? Yeah. And then at the end of it, whatever is the unreacted acid will react with FAS. You add the FAS and then that will go, and then there is an indicator that is added in order to calculate how much of an indicator is added. And we essentially calculate how much of FAS was used. The amount of FAS used is estimated, and from there what is the amount of acid that is used is estimated. So you have a blank sample which has only no water samples, only sulfuric acid and FAS. Then you have a sample which has water plus sulfuric acid and FAS. Then the difference between these two will give you there is a formula for doing it. I will not give it here. So we won't be doing any calculations for this. So the COD is I think a more is an indicator. It does not rely on the conditions that you have. It's also faster than the BOD. You can do it fairly quickly. You can also do it simultaneously. There are equipment to do that. There are of course other interferences in COD also. There's something which you which chemical. This is a chemical reaction. So in sulfuric acid, react with a lot of things. If something is there in the water, it may interfere with the reaction with this ferrous FAS and excess this thing, also with the oxidation itself. Those interferences must be separately dealt with. Sometimes these interferences you will only know if you do the full analysis of the water. So the one problem with the sulfuric acid method is if there is something else in the water that is also consuming sulfuric acid, you won't know that. Yeah, so you won't know that. So you must have another method by which you only look at organic load. So you are looking at organic load. So we are looking at chemical oxygen demand. In general, it will take everything. It's taking care of all the compounds. If that's what you are interested, that's fine. But if you are looking at organic load specifically, it's carbonaceous. We are talking about carbon compounds. But then you can't be sure if it is only carbon that the acid is reacting with. It could be few other things. It could be something else, whatever is there in the water. So it's a bit of a tricky question. So you have to analyze a lot of things and then correct for the COD. Yeah. Okay. There is another method which is called as TOC. It's called a total organic carbon to correct whatever we said in the COD. So we are only interested in carbon here. Sometimes because a lot of things, see when you do wastewater analysis, we are interested in total nitrogen, phosphorus, carbon, everything, sulfur, all those things are important from a water quality perspective when we are interested in the overall what is happening in the chemistry of the water. But from the context we are looking at the course, we talked about whatever we talked about now in terms of partitioning and all that. This is a very important parameter, total organic carbon. This is also important because sometimes when people are analyzing whether a particular method is working or not working, they look at total organic carbon in the water. So they want to see, especially when I'm looking at degradation in the in water, we have biodegradation or any other degradation, you would like to see what's going on. And the one of the ways in which people check is also using this. The biggest difference between this and the other two methods are that those are surrogate methods. You will get milligrams per liter, but that milligrams per liter is not direct carbon. This will give you carbon. This is actual carbon. If I am saying it's total organic carbon, it is total organic carbon. There I am saying it's BOD, it's biological oxygen demand. It's a concentration of oxygen you are measuring, and it's a concentration of sulfuric acid that you are measuring. It does not directly reflect on the amount, unless you calibrate BOD and COD with something actual amount of carbon. So they have to be used in that context only. So TOC will give you, if it says milligrams of carbon, if it says milligrams per liter, it's milligrams per liter of carbon, whatever is the carbon that is there in there. So the analysis of this is a little more sophisticated, and we go down to much lower concentrations in this. So in water, I will just briefly describe the method to you. So in this TOC is organic carbon. What we measure is initially what is called as total carbon, TC is total carbon, because carbon in water can also be inorganic, yeah, in the form of what? Carbonates. The carbonates are there, that is inorganic carbon. So if you are looking at total organic carbon, this is TC equals TOC plus TIC, inorganic carbon, OC plus IC. Total carbon is OC plus IC. So the instrument itself doesn't care about OC or IC. You have to remove IC before you do the OC. So the way we remove IC is we add something that will convert all the release all the carbon dioxide that is there associated with carbonate. Usually we do it with some acid, something like HCl or something. We add a little bit of HCl, it will all go to CO2 will come out. You have to bubble it out, and then the rest of the carbon that is there is all organic carbon. Yeah. So the organic carbon, the water is added to a catalyst, added to a reactor, is added to a which basically does oxidation. All the carbon is oxidized, it is catalytic oxidation at high temperature, and it will release, it will give you carbon dioxide or carbon monoxide, and this is measured using a near infrared detector, IR detector. So this part I will explain a little bit later in the next section. This is what is what we call as spectroscopy. Okay. And there are different kinds of spectroscopies. There is atomic spectroscopy, molecular spectroscopy. As the word, what it means is that we are using a, in this case we are using something to the material that is there going through behaves, interacts with radiation in this case. In this case infrared, it interacts with infrared and gives some signal, and that signal is inferred in terms of CO2 or CO or whatever it is. So each of these spectroscopy techniques have a specific characteristic that you can probe, and that based on that you can learn more about the sample. We will talk about this little bit more as we go deeper into this. This again does not give you any specific breakup of the carbon that is going in. It is taking all the carbon, it is doing something little more than, it is doing exactly what COD and BOD reactions are doing, but it is not changing the form, we are measuring what is coming out. Okay. But by a way of process we are doing the same thing, we are oxidizing everything, making it CO2, and the CO2 and CO is measured physically. So this instrument, so we measure the total carbon, and if it only contains OC we call it as total organic carbon, we subtract IC. There is also another way in which the IC can be analyzed also by using some other acid and all that, so that is also possible, some other reactor, some other catalyst, but this is general mechanism. So the total organic carbon instrument is expensive. It is more expensive, it is it cost up in, I don't know, a few years back it used to cost about several lakhs, I think tens of lakhs. Okay. Compared to BOD and COD which are very cheap, you do not need a DO meter and you need a few small things, you can get it done maybe a couple of lakhs and you can run it continuously. So you get more information and more cost, you get less information but less cost. So this is typically the way in which analysis runs. Okay. All analysis protocols are like that. So you get more information, you have more cost. Okay. In this there is another category called NPOC, which is called as non-purgeable organic carbon. I will just take 5 more minutes and be done. What this means is that you are still doing the same thing, you are adding a sample into it, but before it goes into the sample, I will purge my sample. What it means is that any volatile organic compounds are all gone, they are taken away. Whatever is there is the non-volatile part which is then sent through that catalyst and then carbon dioxide comes out. Anyway, this is for information when you go and one very good source for how instruments work is their catalog, is their the catalog and their manual itself. It will give you sometimes the theory of by which the instrument is supposed to work and all that. So you can get a lot of information about that and the interferences. They will not tell, a lot of interferences are not mentioned expressly. People like you or whoever is using it have to find this out sometimes. So somebody will say the instrument works well, but then you find out that it does not work well for some set of conditions. There are interferences that, so you have to report it. And somebody like the CPCB or the US EPA will catch that and say, verify it, and then say, so this instrument cannot be used for these conditions. You will see a lot of examples when you see the next this thing. So, you also have to calibrate this instrument, okay. Calibration of this is done by putting carbon, known amounts of carbon into your water and getting a signal. So, you will put actual infrared, this is infrared signal versus carbon mass. So, in this case carbon mass is in terms of volume, you are making a concentration of a certain, this instrument will take a certain volume, say it will take 10 ml, 10 ml is injected into this catalyst. So, 10 ml of a solution multiplied by the concentration will give you the mass of carbon that is present in this. So, the calibration is done in terms of concentration rather than mass, because that is more convenient for us to do. Nobody is going to be calculating. So, since you are not adding, you are just adding a fixed volume of a particular this thing. You do not need to calibrate mass, you can calibrate concentration directly, you do not have to worry about recalculating the concentration and all that, it is directly concentration calibration. So, you will get this thing by changing the concentration of carbon in your standard. Prepare different standards for different carbon. So, there are some standard methods of what to use and all that. So, you can go and look at this website called www.standardmethods.org. This refers to this this method, the BOD method that is that was mentioned, standard method for the examination of water and wastewater. This is the standard methods and wastewater.